It had to happen. It's the beginning of a new year, so it's only fitting that we start with one of the earliest arcade games, Pong. It was released in 1972 by Atari, originally being a simple training exercise for Alan Alcorn, creator of the game. The common misconception is that Pong was the first arcade game ever made, when in reality the first arcade game was Computer Space, released in 1971 by Nutting Associates. However, what makes some people ignore Computer Space is its learning curve, as well as its complexity, which made it a failure according to GSN's video game documentary. But with Pong, players could easily interpret and understand the game's main concept, and most, if not all players, inevitably got hooked within the first 5 seconds. Because of this, Pong became one of the first video games to reach mainstream popularity, and is considered today as the first commercially successful video game, leading to the start of the video game industry. So I guess those misconceptions can be understood. Now, let's have a look at the game. It features simple two-dimensional graphics, simulating a table tennis scenario. Yep, it's a sports game. The objective, as I said, is extremely simple. You're presented with two lines and a dot. The two lines represent paddles, and the dot represents the ball.
Tell us something we don't know.
Shut up! You control one paddle, which you can only move up and down, and you use these paddles to hit the ball back and forth to each other. Your goal is to earn more points than your opponent. You earn a point every time your opponent fails to return the ball to you. The game ends when one of you has reached 11 points. What's great about this game is its simultaneous two-player action. When it's just you playing, you've got the computer to beat, but when you're playing this game with a friend, it's a lot more fun. And even though the concept is really simple, that doesn't mean it's an easy game. It's harder than it looks. Give it a try and you'll see what I mean. And that's pretty much it as far as the gameplay goes. Like I said, it's pretty straightforward. Those are the kind of games Atari does best. So, I don't know what to do now. I mean, I'm supposed to keep the gameplay portion going for at least 3 minutes. I mean, what do I do when I have a game that's too straightforward to carry on for that long? I guess we'll just sit back here for a little bit and watch the game. Yeah, let's do that. Let's just kick back and relax for a few minutes. You know what, never mind, let's just move on. Developing the game was an interesting process. After producing Computer Space, Nolan Bushnell decided to form a company to produce more games by licensing ideas to other companies. This became the origination of Atari Incorporated. Alan Alcorn was hired soon afterward for his familiarity with electrical engineering and computer science. He did not have any experience with video games, however.
Are you trying to tell me how to do my job?
So, he was assigned a project secretly meant to be a warm-up exercise. He was to create a simple game with one moving spot, two paddles, and digits for scorekeeping, which obviously came to be Pong. The idea was inspired by a similar table tennis game for the Magnavox Odyssey, the world's first home video game console. After looking at the schematics for Computer Space and deciding that they were too impossible to read, Alcorn went on to create his own designs for the game, which included dividing the paddle into 8 segments, in order to change the ball's angle of return. He also made it so the speed of the ball accelerated the longer it was kept in play, and in addition, prevented the paddles from leaving the screen. Upon viewing the prototype, Bushnell and his co-founder Ted Dabney were so impressed that they decided that this game had a chance at becoming a profitable product, and went on to test its marketability. So, in September of 1972, Pong was installed first at a local bar, where it was set up near the other entertainment machines, which ironically included Computer Space. As a result, Pong became an overnight hit, and its popularity continued to grow over the next week and a half. The prototype later began experiencing mechanical difficulties, however, and upon inspection, the problem was revealed to be, get this, an overflow of quarters. What does that tell you? It wasn't until 1974 the idea of Home Pong was introduced, which involved taking the original game and connecting it to a home television. Atari agreed, and they soon set to work. The first units of Home Pong were manufactured under the name of Sears, who at the time were helping Atari produce copies. But by 1976, Atari was able to put their own name on the product. However, all was not well in the eyes of Ralph Baer, inventor of the Magnavox Odyssey. Under the influence of Sanders Associates, Magnavox filed a lawsuit against Atari in 1975. It was argued that Atari had infringed on Baer's concept of electronic ping-pong, a claim that was backed with the evidence of their game's development dating back to 1966. An agreement was offered to Atari to become a licensee for $700,000, and it also included Magnavox obtaining the rights to all Atari products developed over the next year. To avoid this, Atari decided to delay the release of their products for exactly that time. Wow, clever move. But anyway, Since Pong's initial success, competitors started making their own copies and imitations of the game. Atari could do little to stop these. They had not filed for patents on the technology used in the game. So, Bushnell felt the best way to compete against this was to create better products, which led to the production of various sequels of Pong. Take Pong Doubles, for example, which had a larger screen and turned Pong into a four-player game instead of two. There were now two paddles on each side, hitting the ball back and forth. You could even play one-on-one if you happened to be ambidextrous. Another was Super Pong, which was made available for home. Now home players could select from four different variations of Pong games, and what helped in the marketing of this one was that Atari had now become a household name, and was therefore more recognizable than the many clones that were being released. Quadra Pong came afterward, in some cases under another name, Elimination. It was another four-player version of Pong, but it had two of the paddles moving horizontally across the top and bottom instead of vertically. Each player starts with 4 points and loses 1 point each time the ball goes into their goal. If the player loses all four of his points, he's removed from the game and his goal closes. The game ends when only one player is left. Later on, Bushnell released Breakout, a single-player variation of Pong, where your objective is to remove all the blocks in a wall at the top of the screen, using your paddle and a ball. Breakout soon got its own stream of clones and imitations, such as Arkanoid, Alleyway, and Break-em-All. Along with these sequels, there came remakes and arcade compilations, with Pong included. On gaming platforms such as the Sega Mega Drive, PSP, and Nintendo DS, Atari has released several assemblages of their greatest hits, and Pong, of course, has been included in each one. If you think about it, it'd be considered a great injustice if it wasn't. After all, popular culture today has had its share of references and praises to Pong, TV shows, modern video games that pay their tribute, and much more. Even though it wasn't the first ever video game, it has definitely left its mark on today's society. Kinda weird, isn't it? All it was two lines and a ball, and yet today it's so often revered in the world of video games. Without it, would the name of Atari even be known? Perhaps. But now we know how their simplicity method came about. And for that, I think we all have much to owe to Pong. Since it's been requested, I'll be taking a look at the OutRun series next month. See you then.